So I invite you to take a nice deep breath. And as we exhale, let go. Let go of all the activity that has come before this moment in time, so that we may open the space to let God's love go deeper. We open ourselves, living, loving presence, to this time of prayer and meditation, that we may let your love, your presence, and the power of your presence go deeper, be felt deeper into our being this morning. What a blessing it is to know the power of connecting in this way with you, loving Spirit. What a blessing to be in a community that lifts each other up. That feels and knows and expresses the power of this prayer time. Oh God, living presence, how we thank you. From the depths of our being, we thank you for this time, this place, this community, this ministry, and the light that expresses out from it. From the essence and core of our being, we say, thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, for answered prayer, for the light brought to each prayer we send forward, for every name in the prayer box, for any names you would speak silently or aloud. For each one, we know that your presence, God, brings about the highest and best in whatever area of each blessed one's life. Right now, in these moments, we know it is so. And we send that same blessing to every man, woman, and child on our planet that if they're feeling alone or unseen, that we know you are with them as protection and guidance and direction for this and our many abundant blessings. We say thank you, thank you, thank you, in the name and the nature of that living Christ presence within each one of us and our brother, way shower, master teacher, Jesus. We thank you, and so it is. Amen and amen.
So I sense that some of you are still in the meditation, in the prayer. That's a good thing. Nod your head if you know what I'm talking about. When Leilani prays, you know you've been prayed with. Amen? Why is that? She's not big. She's not demanding. Why is that? That's because she's a prayer warrior. Amen? Boom. I've never heard that term prayer warrior, but we've coined it now. We've coined a phrase. Our prayer chaplains, who we're dedicating in a few moments, are prayer warriors. In other words, they have said prayer matters to me enough that I'm going to go spend hours of my time. And listen, they're all busy, just like all of us. I'm going to go away, I'm going to spend money, I'm going to spend time, I'm going to get with a bunch of people I don't know, and I'm going to do something I've never done before, but I feel some calling within me to do it, so I'm going to learn how to pray so I can make myself, my life, and my church better. I want to acknowledge them again for that. That's really good. Yeah, so I think the word warrior is really about somebody who does something, what, with a lot of vigor, with a lot of character, with a lot of, right? A warrior, hoo-ah, right? That's a warrior. Somebody who does not give up. So what I believe the world needs right now is a bunch of prayer warriors. And that doesn't mean you only pray. Can I also hear an amen to that? Because if prayer was enough, it would have worked by now. Hear me. We're all praying. Okay, so prayer, as we've been traditionally taught, prayer is to convince God to do something that God is withholding because we have not been good enough. That's what we've learned. That's what I learned. Anybody else learn that? Only me knows, all of us. Right? In some way or another, and if you didn't learn it, Hollywood taught it to you. That big guy up there on the throne, long beard. Definitely a white guy. Yeah, big long beard, that big gold chain with a big G on it. Like that big old rapper chain, right? G for God. That if we can just do it good enough, maybe God would give us a gift. And if not, watch out for that lightning bolt, right? So prayer is really... you know, Unity's co-founder, Charles Fillmore, had a deep prayer life, but really we owe the Unity movement to his wife, Myrtle, who really healed herself through the use of affirmative prayer. But Charles is mostly known for his words about it. But he said very simply, that prayer is man's trying to connect with God. So simple. We live in a finite world, and we're yearning to connect with the infinite, with the divine. And this is the mode we know to go about doing it. So there's all different, you know, types of prayers. We've all heard of the foxhole prayers. You've heard of those, right? So those are the help me God prayers. You've heard the statement, there's no atheist in foxholes. That's because everybody says, help me God. Nothing wrong with that kind of prayer. But what prayer really is for, so yes, prayer is our wanting to know God, but prayer is to lift up, align our human consciousness, in other words, the lower self of us that we all have that always wants to run our show. Prayer is to lift that part up into the higher self and for us to align with the God aspect of our own being, the God aspect that's everywhere present. So we pray ultimately to align ourselves with God, right? In religious science, I might even say God mind, or even with law itself, spiritual law itself. So, but remember, God is not up on a throne somewhere. Even when I say the word, it just almost instantly gives you that connotation. So we try to unravel that as much as we can. It's one of the things I always say I love about Judaism. God should be a mystery. It's G-D. It's not even pronounceable, because as soon as we give it a name, we've defined it. Even in unity, we try with the words mother, father, God. We're trying to at least bring in the feminine aspects, but then God's a woman and a man instead of just a man. It's still really limiting. So, see, instead of really us being made in God's image, we've made God in our image. We're made in God's image in that the spiritual nature of God resides within us. So you might be asking yourself, what are you wanting to say today? Or maybe I'm asking myself that. What am I wanting to say today? Well, I want to encourage you to do the spiritual work that's been asked of you, all of us, so that we can change the world. But we start with our own lives first. And then once we do align ourselves with God mind, then divine right action comes after that. We don't just pray, but we start there. Because if you don't start there, the ego's running things, and we see how well that goes. Amen. I definitely want a strong amen on that one. Amen. So why would we want to be a prayer warrior? You know, if you're a social worker, or maybe you... or a photographer, or maybe you are retired. What does that mean? What does it mean to be a prayer warrior if you're not a prayer chaplain, you're not a minister, maybe you're a professional musician? How does this apply to your life? Well, number one, life gets better because you're happier because you're connected to God. Number one. Number two, you get guidance for your life. You know what steps to take next without getting the rug yanked out from under you. Now, I'll tell you, life happens. So, but then you can get back to center when you pray. So life gets better. We get guidance for our lives. I want to talk a little bit about that, about getting guidance. I have some friends, and we all kind of use those terms, get guidance, because we all have pretty regular meditation practices where we are getting messages of what we believe God is directing us to do. So the idea of when you pray, you're not only talking, you're doing what? You're listening. I've heard people say prayer is talking to God, meditation is listening. That's a little simplified, but that's the idea, is that there is a time to speak the word, but then there's also a time to listen, right? So we want to be present, we want to be available, we want to be open, we want to be receptive. But that happens over time, because first we have to create a relationship with God, ultimately. Now, unlike the next person, if something is tough in life, all of a sudden my prayer life is upgraded instantly. Anybody else do that? My prayer life goes through an instant upgrade. As soon as something happens, I'm not expecting. Or maybe I'm knocked off center a little bit. Or maybe I hear a news report. Or somebody I love is sick. Something. Then suddenly, I don't miss it. As a matter of fact, it's going on all the time. So, but we first want to establish a relationship with God through our prayer life. As we do that, life begins to get better. And then we can begin receiving guidance. So, what I want to say about the guidance thing, now I've said this before, but I think it's worth repeating because maybe you weren't here. And maybe I didn't even say it just like this. And anyway, no matter what I say, you'll hear what you want anyway. I love that. When we really move into living life from a more spiritual way, we are listening with almost a sixth sense. And what we're doing really is listening with our soul, right? Some people call that the intuition, but it's all the same thing. So, but when we're new in at some of this, sometimes we ask really large questions that we're not quite ready to handle, and that we cannot distinguish the voice between the ego and spirit. Raise your hand if you know what I mean. You say, I'm trying to make a decision, but I'm not sure which voice to listen to. Right? So here's a couple of ways I want to give you to really be able to do that. Okay, the ego argues, in other words, this is the lower self. Spirit knows. The ego gives you pros and cons, and is often in a very loud voice. The scriptures say God comes in the still small voice, right? Not in the earthquake, not in the fire, but in the still small voice. In the still small voice. So before you go getting guidance, you got to be able to distinguish between those voices. If that voice is ever telling you to hurt yourself or others, you're listening to the wrong one. Here's the other indicator, and this is tough, so listen, we'd say to kids, put your listening ears on. It's more than likely going to be what you don't want to do. Okay. Meaning, spirit is going to move you out of your comfort zone because the spirit in you wants to grow. Spirit in you is tired of being where you are and is saying, let's move, let's grow, let's change. And you're going, that can't be me, God. You must be talking to somebody else. He should do that. Right? That's what all the prophets did. Boy, if you start saying that, you're right on target. All those prophets, even Jesus himself said, hey, you know that cross thing? I'd really like not to do that. And God said, yeah, okay, not my will. Thine be done, see? That's a surrender. See there? So this was a self-realized individual. Even he had a hard time. So I'm saying the spiritual life, if you're not a warrior about it, if you give up real easily, it's not going to really make that big of a difference in your life, because you got to be committed for it to make a change. Even when you are committed, life happens. You know, I feel my prayer and meditation time is like taking a sanity pill. You know, remember they used to have that commercial and they would fry this egg? And they would say, this is your brain on drugs? Well, I always want to say, this is your brain not meditating. It's just fried. And even when you are meditating, sometimes you just get a break for the 20 minutes. Right? So the idea as you're praying and as you're meditating is then you want to take that spiritual energy out into the rest of your life. Some days we're more successful than others. Can I have an amen? Right, so we want to pray. We want to be a prayer warrior because we want a relationship with God. We want our lives to be better. And we want to be able to receive guidance that helps us make good decisions to move our soul forward. In other words, we want to act in our soul's best interest. Oftentimes, when you are receiving guidance, remember that the guidance that you receive will probably be something that your ego would have never thought of. And it's always interesting to me, as I've looked back on my life, when I've really trusted the inner guidance, it is the opposite of what the ego wanted me to do. The opposite. And logically, it never made sense. But then after I make the decision and get a little time, then I go, oh, that's why I was supposed to do that. But at the time, it's like my soul knew more than this personality self. And the mind thinks it knows everything and wants to make all your decisions for you. No. Say with me, no. Right, like, I mean, like, no. No, we want to be listening with the soul, right? In prayer with the soul. So it's important to talk just for a moment about how do we pray? How do we pray? So as I said, there are the help me God prayers. And first of all, I should say about this, there's no wrong way to pray. Every prayer is a beautiful prayer. Because when we pray, the moment we pray is a moment of surrender. It's a moment of saying, I cannot do this of myself. And you know, even Jesus said that. I of my own self can do nothing. It is the Father within me that does the work. Every Sunday morning in our praying, by the way, we always say that. It is not I, but the Christ within who does the work. Right? So the moment that you pray, you've just done a good spiritual thing for your soul because you're saying the personality me does not know what to do. And as long as we fight and resist that, that's when we get into trouble. Mm-hmm. So Jesus said, pray like this, our Father who art in heaven. There's a lot of research. I've studied the Lord's Prayer many times and the Aramaic. I even had a classmate that was all into that Aramaic. She could say it, you know, start to finish it. It always kind of freaked me out. But anyway, and the Aramaic is beautiful. But about the only part that we think probably Jesus actually said is our Father, and correctly translated probably means eternal birther, just for the record. Although I have love our Father myself, so. But it's in other words, but it's God first in whatever prayer you pray, our Father. Okay. In unity, we tend to pray, as the song says, we tend to accentuate the positive. We pray as if it is already done. We pray as if it's already done. In other words, if you are not feeling well, we say, thank you, God, that divine healing energy is moving through me now. Thank you, God, I am being healed right now. Thank you, God, that I am healed. Now, when I first got into Unity, I said, my God, these people are crazy. I didn't understand. So what I had to start doing is work with the idea that that my old way of praying was kind of keeping me stuck in an old way of thinking. I didn't realize that. That my old way of praying was just having me begging all the time when this new way of praying was affirming the good and believing that actually God's will for me was good and that what was true on the absolute realm and the heavenly realm could possibly be true here as well. Amen? And so that as I began to practice praying in this new way, I started to experience more of God's good in this realm. And I felt differently about how it was going to come forth. Rather than waiting and begging for God to do it, I thought, okay, moment, let's take this next step. It shifted everything. So remember, there's no wrong way to pray, but you might want to try, if you haven't ever before, praying affirmatively. If there's a job you want, you pray that the job you have is waiting for you now. Your job is here now. If you and your partner are trying to create a baby, thank you, God, for bringing our right and perfect baby now. It is done in and after the nature of Jesus Christ. God's will for me is good. If it is a new home you want, thank you, God, for bringing the right and perfect home to me and for opening my eyes to it the second I see it. Thank you, God, that I'm going to drive right to my new home right here, right now, because you love me that much that I don't have to work so hard for it. Amen? Amen? Can you feel the difference in your soul about that? But there's no wrong way to pray. It's all good. Look at somebody, say, it's all good. Just pray. It's all good. Just pray. So I love the scriptures. As you know, I grew up with the Bible, and I've read it through many times. And I always, for some reason, come back to Matthew because Genesis and Matthew, that's got everything you would ever want to need for life. And I like the master's teaching on prayer. And this section in Matthew 6, the little title on the top, it says concerning prayer. It's like, if you weren't sure, here's how to do it. Whenever you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and on the street corners, so that they may be seen by others. But truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But this is the important part. Whenever you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. Beautiful, right? So, to me, this implies it is the private spiritual practice, the spiritual work that you do when no one is looking, the time in silence and prayer, the time where you're willing to get quiet and unplug from everything. This is where you know God. This is the time that really matters. All these other things we do, they might be good things, but nothing matters as much as that. And then when we receive the manifestation, this is really important. We always want to give thanks for all the good that God has for us. Right? We always want to give thanks for all the good God has for us. Remembering that all the good that we have is from God, and the amount of good that you have right now is according to your level of how much you can receive. Right? So we want to pray so we can enlarge our bliss tolerance. So what would life be like if you increased your bliss tolerance? And just breathe into that idea. Breathe for a second. What would it be like? How good could life be if every day you were praying, you were affirming the good that God has for you in life, and then acting as your inner guidance was telling you? How good could life be? So just take a moment to recall all the good in your life. Take a moment in quiet to give thanks. Thank you, God, for all that we have received. We are so grateful. We are so blessed. Thank you for the knowledge, the wisdom, the teaching that as we affirm the good, that begins to manifest in every aspect of our lives. Thank you, God, for the souls among us that have said yes to be of higher service to the world through their prayers. We know each one of us in this room is called to be a prayer warrior so that we can change our lives, our church, our city, our state, and even the world for the better. Help us, God, remember to pray. So for our time of prayer, celebration, and worship today, we are grateful, we are blessed. Together we say, thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Together, thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. And so it is. Amen.